Sweet in the morning. Oh Lord, it's sweet in the morning.
Sweet in the morning, sweet in the morning, sweet in the morning.
This is an interview with Mrs. Annie L. Levison for the Birmingham Civil Rights Institute's Oral History Project. I'm Dr. Horace Huntley. We're at Miles College, July 5th, 1995. Thank you, Ms. Levison, for coming and sitting with us today.
Thank you, Mr. Huntley.
I just want to start by asking just a few general kinds of questions, just about background. Tell me just a bit about your parents. Where are your parents from?
Well, my mother was from Montgomery, Alabama, and my father was from Huntsville.
Oh, and where did they meet?
Well, they met, I guess, around about 1928.
In Birmingham?
In Birmingham.
Mm-hmm. So they met halfway.
Right. They met on the south side of Birmingham, where my mother was staying.
Okay. Tell me just a bit about their education. How much education did each of them have?
Well, my mother, like I said, she was born in Montgomery, but she came to Birmingham at an early age. And she went to Cameron School, and she went part-time to industrial. She didn't finish high school. She went to the 11th grade. And my father, he only had an 8th grade education.
And what kind of work did they do?
Well, my mother, she worked in the laundry, and she was a meat cutter. And my father was a truck driver.
Where did she work?
Well, she worked at American Pillars Laundry, and she worked at Miro's grocery store.
Okay, American
what? Pillars.
Pillars Laundry.
Uh-huh. They was named together. It was two laundries that was joined together.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And your father drove truck within
yeah,
the city?
Yeah, within the city. He drove for Kirkpatrick in later years, but in his early years, he worked at Moody's Bicycle Shop, repairing bicycles and fixing new bicycles so they could sell them. Then he went on to driving a truck.
I see. How many brothers and sisters did you have?
I have one brother and one sister.
Okay, and where did you fit in?
I'm the oldest.
You're the oldest. You're the elder statesperson.
Right, right.
Okay. Where did you go to elementary school?
I went to Cameron School.
Cameron School.
On 14th.
And where was Cameron located?
On 14th Street and Avenue H.
Okay, and Avenue H at that time was what?
It was Avenue H, but now it's 8th Avenue.
8th Avenue.
South.
University Boulevard. And
right.
And, okay, right where the student center sits.
That's it. That was Cameron School.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And what do you remember about Cameron School?
Well, I remember my schooling was very good. I had some good teachers and good meals because Miss McClung, she could cook. And I loved to eat her macaroni and cheese. But mostly, too, I remember Mrs. Sheehy. She was my favorite teacher, and Mrs. Jones. Mrs. Sheehy would let me, I was a pretty good reader, and I was a pretty good talker. So I used to, kind of bluff my way through, and she would let me go from class to class and carry the plays. Because, see, we didn't have auditoriums in school then. We would have to go from room to room to present plays. And I would go, and I would give the briefing of the play. And I love that.
Mm-hmm. So you started in an early age being
rather
outgoing.
Right,
And your teachers recognized that and sort of enhanced
That's true.
Your capability. That's great. Mm-hmm. And then you went on from Cameron to Ullman. And you were at Ullman for 2 years.
2 years.
And then to Parker where you would graduate.
Right.
How did you compare Ullman and Parker? In later years, of course, they became rivals.
Yeah, in later years. But in my time, it was a good school because Mr. Bayer, my favorite principal, he was very nice. And Mr. Whetstone, I'll never forget those two. They was, good because Mr. Whetstone taught biology. But it was a good school because, see, the whites had it. And we went in time the whites got out. So therefore, it was a clean school, and, they had everything in there that we needed, where otherwise, the schools didn't have them. Because even in going to Parker, some of the things that we had at Elmer, we didn't have them at Parker.
Is that because it was a white school?
Right, and some of the equipment was already in there, such as your chemistry, you know, you had all your apparatuses and all of these things. Well, now we had those at Elmer, but Elmer was newer and had more than, you know, than our Parker.
What is your most vivid memory of your days at Parker?
Oh, those were the good days. Well, you know, I like Mrs. Tate because I used to go to home ec with her. And Mr. White, that was my, he was a business teacher. He was very, very good, and he taught me business, how to file and all. And I'll always remember that and keep it in my head. Whatever I do, when I go to put anything together, my mind goes back to him, and I can balance, you know, books and things. That would help me when I started to work in that protective, that business course that I got at Parker High School from Mr. White. It stands out with me very vividly.
You seem to have fond memories of your days in school.
I do. Now, I treasure my school days. I really treasure my school days because I was telling a young lady today that when I was a child coming up, we had good times. You wasn't afraid of anything. And we associated with people. In the neighborhood, everybody, you know, was everybody's mother. And I enjoyed that. And I just wish it was today, but, you know.
What neighborhood did you live in?
I come from the South Side. As we always say, the lower end. I come from 13th Street right. and 12th Street and Avenue D all around in there. That's where I was raised up at. And everybody was everybody's mother. Mm. And when my mother worked, and she would leave in the morning, and Ms. Mary Sanders would make sure that I would get out and go to school on time. And when I come in the evening, I stayed in that house till my mother came. And you and nobody else couldn't get in because I knew better. And the neighbors wasn't going to let nobody come. And that's the thing that, you know, I liked. And when she come in, well, then I go out in the neighborhood and play with, you know, all the children and everything. And we just had a good time. We played, now I played baseball with the children in the yard. And we played marbles and hopscotch, you know, and jacks and all that. And we skated a lot. So I enjoyed that.
How would you compare, then, your days, school days, with what you see happening today with children?
Oh, it's a vast big difference. Because now today, if the teachers had their way and they was dedicated now, you got to have dedicated teachers. And in my day, we had dedicated teachers. They didn't tell you, I got mine, you got to get yours. They said, sit down and get this. And when they said it, you listen. And from the experience with raising my own child in the school and now, the children are just out of hand. They don't listen to nobody. And the teachers, when they find out that the teachers couldn't whip them, oh, buddy, they just walk all over the teachers. The teachers cannot teach because the parents are not doing their jobs at home.
You attributed then the difference is based on
discipline,
lack of discipline.
A lack of discipline now compared to, you know, when I was coming up, we had discipline because they would send a note home by you. You better carry that note home. And if you carried that note home and you had misbehaved in that class, you was going to get a whooping. And your parents didn't have to bring you back. They didn't have to bring you back to school because the teacher knew you had your whooping.
Well, we always thought that prior to desegregation of schools, when the schools were, in quote, integrated, that the schools would be better. How do you view that?
Well, I know we said it would be better if they was integrated, but it have hurt us a lot, too. Sure, I like the integration of, you know, schooling to the point that we have better books and we get the lessons that they're getting like now in science. We didn't have science until we got to the ninth grade. They having science in the fourth and fifth grade. Now, this is the part that I like, but the teachers and... integration, it just don't work together. To me, it don't. Because I feel like I've run across some white teachers in the classrooms, and they, even with my grandson, and they don't show me anything. They don't have any spunk about themselves. They come in the classroom with old joggling, nasty pants on, and they stand up on their head. How can you teach a child when you look like you just come out of off the field somewhere yourself? And then they don't communicate with the children well. Johnny, you just go on. Whatever you say, it's all right. That's not communication.
There's black and white teachers?
Black and white teachers. But mostly, the teachers that I run across, what do this, is the white teachers. Now, I had this experience. I hit a bush school with my grandson. I've ran across of that. And I said, now, with my son down the Wilson school, Mrs. Rucker was very good with her. She just was afraid of us because that's when integration had first started out.
Mrs. Rucker, was she a white teacher?
She was a white principal, okay. And she was afraid of them. But they had some good teachers there. They had some very good teachers because my son was slow with math. And this teacher, Mrs. Ford, she told me the book to go and get. And she went back to the basics with him on this book. And this enabled him to, you know, help himself. And she pulled him up. But now the teachers don't, you know, they don't seem to want to pull the children up. They are afraid. And they just let the children do what they want to do.
Why do you think they are afraid?
Because we as grandparents, the parents are not doing the jobs at home. We are letting the children, if he say, I don't want to eat. Okay, Johnny, you don't have to eat. But see, instead of saying, Johnny, go in there and eat and be firm with it, we are not doing the job. That's what it is. It all stems from home. And like about this civil rights thing, they just don't, I don't know, we don't teach them at an early age how we got what we got.
Are you suggesting that the kids know little about
that's right.
the movement itself?
That's right.
Why do you think that's the case?
Because the parents don't talk about it at home. Because the younger parents don't even know anything about themselves. When they passed, I guess when the children are, anyone that's past 25 now, even I say 20, they don't know anything about the movement. Because we are not educating our children at home about these movements. They don't know anything about it.
Do you think that the school system has a role to play in passing this information on?
Yes, because just like we learned the white history, learn the black history also. Now, I listen all the time to the TV and the radio when people come up and read the editorial section. We don't need to know anything about blacks. You see it every day. But your textbooks are all about white people. It's everything the white man wrote. Nothing is in there about the black. See?
Birmingham school system now is about 90%. Black.
Right. And they
should. Administration is primarily black. What's mm-hmm. the problem?
They just not teaching their course. They do not have a black history course. See, when we was coming up, we had a black history course. Because that's when we learned about Booker T. Washington, George Washington, Carver and all. You remember this little red book? I think Woodrow Wilson wrote that book, I believe. But anyway, it was a black history book. We studied that book. We knew all about all those Dubois and all of them. We knew about them. But do our children know about them now? Uh-uh. They don't know poems, and they don't even read the poetry in the book. They don't read these black backgrounds. They don't do that. They don't. You ask them who Booker T. Washington was, they wouldn't tell you. They couldn't tell you nothing. Why? Because it's not being taught. And half of the young black teachers don't even know about it themselves. That's why it's not being taught.
So then you then are suggesting that the educational system at the university level as well as the high school level are wanting for this kind of information.
That's right. Do you know I found out who asking you about the black history? White people. They are studying our history. We are not studying our own history. They see you in the store and thing, and some people can, I guess, have friendly faces and things, but they'll start talking, bring up a conversation, and they are worried about the black history. And they start talking and asking you questions about black
history.
They're
interested in learning.
That's right.
History.
They are interested in learning our history.
And you're saying that blacks are not interested in
learning our history? No, we are not. We're interested in the rap. And interested in, like, I see them with these pants all halfway down, and I want to grab every one of them. Because I guess it's behind my grandson all the time. I watch his heels. That's the stuff. Let your pants go down.
After you went on to Parker. After Parker, after you graduated from high school, what did you do?
Well, when I graduated from high school, I was so in love. I got that diploma, and I wanted to go to college. And my father, he said he didn't have any money, and at that time, I didn't know about grants and all. There wasn't any grants, rather. So I went on and I married. Then after I married, he say, well, if you and your husband can't make it, I'll send you to college. I was like, I'm married now. So that was the end of that. Mm-hmm. And I didn't worry about any more schooling.
So did you go to work after that? Were you a housewife?
I was a housewife for a while.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you actually left Birmingham and moved to, where did you move?
St. Louis.
St. Louis.
Uh-huh. I left Birmingham in 51.
Uh-huh. And how long did you remain in St. Louis?
I remained in St. Louis until 57.
Mm-hmm. And then you returned in 1957. In 1956, the Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights was organized because the NAACP had been outlawed from operating in the state. So the movement was organized to sort of fill that void. You came in 1957. Did you get actively involved with the movement at that time?
Yes, I did, because of my pastor and our church. It was involved.
Who was your pastor?
Reverend N.H. Smith, Jr.
And your church?
New Pilgrim Baptist Church. And we was highly involved in it because our choir was singing. When they would meet at our church, where we would open up and they would have, you know, a hallelujah good time, shouting and singing and going on and praying. And, you know, talking about the whites and talking about how we got to pull up by the bootstraps and we're going to have to break these laws and everything. And they would take up money, you know, and all.
Is this in the mass meetings?
In the mass meetings, okay. Mm-hmm. And we would go from church to church, New St. James and all of them, you know, to the mass meetings. And
well, why did you feel it necessary to get involved when you returned to Birmingham?
Well, because it was vast difference between St. Louis and Birmingham. In St. Louis at that time, you were free, still halfway free. You were freer in St. Louis than you was in Birmingham. I could afford to ride the buses and, you know, go, and I saw the young people with jobs waiting on people in the stores and all. Well, in Birmingham, that wasn't happening. See, and you could go to any water fountain and drink. Well, in Birmingham, see, we had the black and white water. So that's why I said, well, I can go help break some of these laws and things.
And some of the segregationists were suggesting that everything was okay in Birmingham until some black people went north and then was influenced by the NAACP and came back with these foreign ideas. Are you suggesting that he was correct?
No, I'm not going to say he was correct. I said there was a vast difference in the two cities. See, well, I was used to drinking the white water and the black water because that's all we could do here. But we're not going to say that the blacks come back and I just wanted to change from, you know, that. It was time for a change. It was time for a change in Birmingham.
When you returned, were you a registered voter?
No, I wasn't when I returned. I became a registered voter in 1957 after I came home.
Okay, can you tell me about the experience of becoming a registered voter?
Yeah, well, we had to go down then and fill out a long questionnaire. I think I filled about 2.5 pages out. They was asking questions about the government, about your people, just a whole lot of nonsense questions.
Do you remember any specific questions that were asked on the questionnaire?
Not right now, I can't, because, honey, that's been a number of years ago.
Yeah, well, all of them, you know, valid questions, or were there any that was...
No, they was you know, they wanted to know who your grandmother was, who your great-grandmother was, and where they originate from. They wanted to know all of your family history, and had any of them ever been in jail, and all of this stuff. And then you had to put down some of the... I think it was the amendments and everything. He was asking you all about that. And the Constitution, they was asking you about questions out of it.
Were these all written, or did you have someone...
They was typed on a piece of paper, a long sheet of paper.
You had to actually write the answers to the questions.
Right.
No one were asking you these questions verbally.
Okay. You was writing. And then you had to pay some poll tax, $1.50. Before you could become a registered voter.
Did you pass the first time?
I passed the first time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, you then became active in the movement. You've told me why. You thought it was just that time.
Mm-hmm.
Were you ever arrested?
Yes, I was.
Can you tell me the circumstances of your arrest?
From riding the bus. I believe we was behind the first one to ride that bus. We boarded the bus. Our pastors carried us, Reverend Smith carried us downtown. So then we boarded the bus at 2nd Avenue. And we met up with Reverend Pfeiffer, the Hendrix brothers, and Mrs. Brown. Those are the ones that we met up with. And the bus was full of people. And we sat right on the front because I sat on the side opposite the driver. You know, they had the two long sides. And Reverend Pfeiffer and Pete sat on the other. Pete and I sat on one side, and Reverend Pfeiffer and Hendrix sat on one, and Mrs. Brunson and all of them. They just, you know, we sat right to the front. Mm-hmm. So the man, he looked back. He said, "I'm not going to move this bus till you all move." And we didn't move, so a lot of the blacks on that, why don't y'all get up and come on back?
Now, this is immediately after you returned from St. Louis, so you're talking about 1957.
That's right, and 57. It was October or the first part of November.
Was this as a result of what had taken place at Montgomery?
No, well, I don't know what had... No, Montgomery hadn't had theirs, I don't think, then.
Yes, they had had theirs, and theirs were over at the time, and the court had ruled that segregation of bus seating was illegal.
Okay, because, see, I was in St. Louis when Montgomery was going
right,
on.
Right, that's right.
Okay, well, I guess it was prior to that then, and Reverend Smith and them said they wanted to test the bus out.
Right.
So that Sunday, he asked for volunteers, and then many people come volunteer. And I also have been teaching school, kindergarten at the church. And I left the job. Pete and I, we went on, you know, got put in jail. But we didn't know we was going to jail, though.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Tell me about that. The bus driver said that he would not move the bus.
No.
And did he threaten you?
Yes, he told us. He said, if you don't go back to that back, I'm going to take all of y'all and put you in jail. So we still didn't say nothing. And Reverend Smith, he got off the bus because he saw, you know, it was going to be some problems. So he was calling the head people so they could, you know, come and all. And Reverend Pfeiffer, he stayed on the bus. So we just started singing.
What about the people in the back, the black people?
Well, they got angry with us because they wanted to go to work over the mountain. And they was telling us to get off the bus and come on to the back. Get off that bus one and all. So we just ignored them. And we sat there and we just sing. So finally, they emptied the whole bus. The whole bus was emptied. And the people from the car barn, they came down and they begged us to get off the bus and we didn't move. So then they called the policeman and we didn't move for him. And there was some nasty police during that time because they called us niggas. They told us, niggas, go to the back of this bus. And we didn't move. We just went right on and sat there and sing. And Reverend Pfeiffer, he's prayed. And then we just sat there, and so they told us, we're going to carry y'all to jail. So they brought us on down. The bus barn was on 4th Avenue then, and they brought us down on 4th Avenue and 13th Street to the barn, and then they brought the paddy wagon and put us in, and we went to jail.
Where did they take you?
To the city jail.
Downtown or South Side?
South Side.
Mm-hmm.
They carried us to the South Side.
And how long did you remain?
Okay, that was on a Monday, and it was about 12 o'clock. So we stayed there to about 3 o'clock that Tuesday morning, full day. And when Brother Shortridge and all, he had put up his funeral home, they say, because, see, the movement didn't have too much money then. And they had to take up, and whatever they taken up, it wasn't enough, and they had to put, you know, up that. And so they got us out. And we came home, and then we had to go back to trial that Friday.
But you were released at 3 o'clock in the morning?
In the morning, mm-hmm. 3 o'clock that morning.
Why do you think you released at 3 in the morning?
They was being nasty. They could have released us earlier, but they just was being nasty. Because they had come up to get us around about 10 o'clock that night.
So you were released then, and then you went to court that same week, right?
The same week. Went to court that Friday.
Tell me about
that. And the court was set up for 11 o'clock that night. And it was round about, I guess around about 12:30 or 71 when they tried us. They locked us back up because the judge was out of town or somebody was out of town. Who else they supposed to get a written habeas corpus from? And Lawyer Billingsley shows with the lawyers for then. And they locked us back up and we had to stay there till Monday. And when we come back that Monday night to trial, it was 12 o'clock again that night.
So you actually were locked up after you had returned for your court date.
That's right.
And you spent the weekend then in jail.
That's right. Spent a whole weekend in jail.
Well, tell me about the experience. What was it like being in jail?
It's an experience nobody wants. Because it was a nasty place. It was filthy in that jail. And the food, the trays they give you with the food on it, they were just as nasty as they'd be. They wasn't washing those trays and nothing. The food wasn't even fitting to eat. And they come around and cut the lights out, and it just was a miserable thing, and them little hard beds in there.
So someone said that they were attempting to teach you a lesson.
That's it. They say, you won't come back no more. So we teach y'all a lesson. Y'all won't come back here no more. But that didn't stop the people.
Didn't stop the movement
at all.
No,
it did not.
Yes.
They went by throngs later.
And this was obviously very early in the, the movement.
It was.
And that was really just the beginning, laying foundation at that time. Then after that, were you involved in the movement?
Yes, I was continuing to go to the meetings and all and pay money, you know, and things like that. I would do that. And I marched with some signs, you know. But then I stopped, you know, marching with them, and I just would go to the meetings. Because I left and went back to St. Louis, and then I come back home. I stayed in St. Louis again about 1 year, then I come back home.
Can you tell me what the typical mass meeting was like?
Well, they would be packed. You could not find standing room. And they would, like I say, would have a lot of singing, you know, and hand clapping and shouting and all. And then people would get up and tell different things that had happened to them. And then they would map out strategies of what to do and how to, in order to break, you know, the segregation and everything, and how to get your rights and things together. And they would tell you that if the policeman approach you, don't try to resist him. Just be humble and go along meekly. Because at that time, you know, that's when they was beating you and everything. So they would tell them, you know, not to resist. And when you go place, do not go alone, but go in groups. See, so that way you wouldn't be attacked by yourself. And you would have somebody to be a witness if anything did happen to you.
Mm-hmm. Were other members of your family involved in the movement?
Well, my brother, he got arrested. He went out there with them when, you know, the school children was being arrested. He went out and he got arrested, too.
Oh, he was one of the school children who were arrested. Where did they
house him? To the fairground.
Fairgrounds.
Okay. Carried him to the fairground.
At that time, what kind of work were you doing?
Well, I was an insurance worker then. I was working for Protective Industrial. I was writing insurance.
I see.
Because I had left the kindergarten at the church. And I started writing insurance.
So you were writing insurance during the 63 demonstrations?
Yes.
Okay. Were you a participant during those demonstrations?
No, I was not.
When you saw your brother going to jail, what kind of emotions did that?
Well, it disturbed me very much, and Mother told me to go home. Cause see, like I told you, Reverend King, them almost missed me when they were saying nonviolence.
What do you mean they almost missed you?
Because I couldn't see myself turning the other cheek then. I couldn't stand for white people to touch me and not hit them back. And so he just about missed me because, see, when they turned that water on those children out there and all, and when they was hurling them like they was cows or something and had those old prongs with them, well, I got angry with them about that because it wasn't right.
But you decided that you would not participate, but were you still attending the meetings?
Well, I was attending the meetings, yes, but I could not participate because I would have fought back. And he said he wanted nonviolent people. So I left.
So were there other activities that you participated in? I mean, were you supportive of the movement?
I was very supportive by paying the money and just, you know, like I say, going to the meetings and all. I was very supportive of that. And if they have any, you know, programs or something, you know, I would go to that. But other than that, marching, or no, I didn't do any more.
Now, you were still a member of New Pirable.
Yes, I'm still a member there.
So your pastor was still actively involved, and your church was actively involved.
Very much so.
This period, what, you know, from your perspective today, looking back on this period of the movement, how would you, if you had the ability to change, for instance, the day that you were arrested and the method that was utilized to get you all arrested, or other things, other methods that were used during the movement, would you change any of those things if you had the ability to change them and maybe do something different?
Well, during that time, no, that was effective. But now it's not effective. We need to sit up and think of other strategies now, because going to jail don't mean anything anymore to them. And it's going to come from the power structure of our sales and our monies. This is where you will hurt. And this is what I would change now.
How do you
I would teach the black people how to keep their monies in their pockets and keep it in the black areas. I would. If you notice, not Birmingham, the whites, because we got a black mayor, they all moving, all the businesses are moving out of Birmingham. And we blacks going over there to Hoover. I don't go to Hoover. And I would teach my dollar not to go to Hoover. I would teach my dollar to stay right where I am, Birmingham.
Are you suggesting then that economics is the key at this point?
That's the key.
And how would you do that? If you keep your money in Birmingham, then you wouldn't go to the Galleria.
No, I would not. I would go out here in Five Points. But this has always been my theory. We need to get our own factories. It's a plenty of people in Birmingham can sew. Black people can really sew. We need to set up and we can give our people jobs, you know? We can create ourselves within ourselves, and we as black people need to buy from one another. But first, we the black people got to know how to treat each other. See, we got to learn how to treat each other. Then when you can treat a person right, they'll come into your business. See, and if you can do that, you'll have it made. Let the white man know, I don't have to depend upon you. Like, you get your material from Japan, I can get mine too. Because the field is open. That man in Japan will sell you material just like he'll sell it to that white man. All he's looking for is that almighty dollar. And when we learn that, and we plant our own vegetables and things and grow them, put our stands up, and then we buy from these stands, we can make it.
In 1963, we were searching for a change in the status quo. That mm-hmm. change came about. Something, though, since then went wrong. What happened? What happened that we are no further along economically today than we are?
Education. We didn't continue to educate our black children in the way of letting them know from whence they came. Like we were saying before, the teaching of it. Okay, and when the children got up, as they come up, nobody was there to tell them anything. Okay, the older people were going to the movements, but we did not bring our young children to the movements. So this is what broke down. This is where the breakdown come in at, because we did not continue to educate our children in mass. Just like they went to jail in mass, we should have kept them into the movement in mass. And we older ones move off the scene, but be there to nurture them, you know, alone. Let one of them become a president of the movement. But we be there to kind of guide them if they need our guidance when we see that they are going to the far left. See, this is what we do. We get into the position and we stay there instead of passing along. So the young people say, well, they're not going to let me do anything. I'm not interested. I'll do my own thing. So this is where the breakdown come in, from not continuing giving that education.
Do you see any changes in that mentality today? Are we moving in that direction? Are we stagnant? Are we moving backwards?
Well, we are kind of stagnant. And some of the young people are taking hope and coming on into the business. Because the Gaynell Hendricks them, I noticed they are this young, thriving people. And
Who is Gaynell Hendricks?
They have the daycare center. They are in Homewood, Bessemer, and Birmingham. She's a young lady, and she's pushing. And I glory in her spunk because, you know, she's striving hard. And we got a lot of black business, but I just brought her up because she's out front. And I noticed when I went to this black business chambers, they had a lot of black business, you know, in there. But a lot of black business are not known to us. Now, this mahogany card store, I go to it out here in Fairfield because, you know, I know that the only way they're going to get up is by the blacks pushing them. And this is what we need to do. Now, some of the young people are moving forward, but we always, we still sit back and won't go out there and help them. This is what we got to do. Now, if I want to head, I'd just sooner go to Western Hill Mall to this Evils girl. It's a young black girl that she was a Lewis. I don't know her first name now. But anyway, I would go to her shop, and I'd just soon give her $150 or $300 for a hat as to give Fifth Avenue $300 or $400 for a hat. See what I mean? So this is what I'm saying. We need to go and cater to our blacks, the young people who are trying and who are trying to bring us up by the bootstrap. Help them to come on up.
So although we did accomplish some things during the civil rights movement, didn't go far enough.
We did not go far enough. When we got that little freedom, it kind of went to our heads. Instead of sticking right there with that education and going on, and like when we boycotted that bus and all, they got what they wanted. Like I say, if they keep their money in their pocket, they can get what they want.
Do you see that happening today?
No, I don't.
Economic boycotts of any
sort? I don't see any. Mm-hmm. See, we don't have any going.
Is there a possibility? Is anyone talking about that kind of?
I haven't heard anybody say anything. But if they got in there, I sure could give them my soapbox off and tell them that because this is what we need. Mm-hmm. This is what we need. And then if we didn't boycott them, like I say, it's enough black people in this city and got money to start a business, get those manufacturers and things going, venture out. Now you're getting all these funeral homes. Stop so many funeral homes and get something else. Because you got too many funeral homes in Birmingham. Every time you look on the corner, it's a new funeral home coming up. Put that money into something else so we can stop killing each other. The ones out there, they're killing each other because they don't have jobs. They sitting at home with nothing to do. They walk around in the streets and they want these gold chains and things, so they're going to rob and steal and kill, sell dope and everything to get it. But we could stop that. And the white man is bringing the dope in. He bring the dope in to us, and we don't have no better sense, because in my neighborhood, it's one ride around there in a red truck, and if I could just get him one time, he wouldn't come back in Titusville no more. He would
just need to get his license plate and give it to the police.
Well, they know it.
They know it.
They know it. They know it, because every house he goes to, it's a black house. And they know this is a dope house. They know
it's
it.
It's known what has happened, but mm-hmm. it's just not that effort
to cut it out.
Those things.
That's right.
Well, Ms. Levison, is there anything else that we have not covered that you would like to just briefly talk about that's related to the movement? Also Birmingham, or maybe even solutions, anything that we have not touched on?
Well, I think we've touched on just about everything. Like I was saying, we got to come together to put Birmingham on a move. What hurts me about Birmingham is we see what's happening, but look like nobody's getting a solution to help it and to move it on. And we got to help our mayor. Now, we got a good mayor. And we got to get in there, stop fighting each other and fighting him and trying to be on the top and all this stuff and put our ideas with him. Because if he would call a community meeting out in Titusville and want some ideas, I'll sure be there to help give him some. And like when the policemen, they haven't come to Titusville yet to have their meetings. But I'm waiting on them to come so I can tell them about these trucks and things come through the neighborhood. They need to know.
Sure.
They need to know. And our children, I just look at Washington School. That's a school that really need to be closed.
Why?
There's no disciplines in there. Those little boys will sell the drugs. They are there. And the policeman sees them when they're not in school. And it's a bunch of them. They wear red and black. And they wear white. And their clothes half off of them. Walk up and down the street when school is in. And I know they see it. And the policeman stay there all the time. So get them little boys that are not going to school and children scared to go to school because they're going to jump on them. A child can't get his lesson and he's scared to go in school. And Ms. Yarb and them, they just can't seem to handle it. So they need some stronger men. We need some men in the system, school system. Some men who are not afraid to handle some of all these, people and things out here. Because the ladies, they know these boys and things jump on these lady teachers. So we need to, revamp that. And, we just as a community need to come together. And I'm a very religious person. And I know I praise all the time about, things. But the Lord tell you to get up off your knees sometime and do something about it. And it's just time for us to do something about it.
Thank you, Ms. Levison. You've been quite a help to us today.
I hope so.
We'll be in touch with you.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Sweet.